Hi, welcome to Enchiridion. 6 million years ago, the skies of Argentina were home to a frightening predator, Argentavis Magnificens, one of the largest birds to ever fly, and a master glider. Argentavis was greatly adapted to take advantage of a large, open habitat, where it could travel across large distances in search of prey. It was equipped with powerful claws, a sharp beak for tearing carrion to pieces, and formidable wings. This type of bird is usually the sign of death. Vultures and scavengers alike all introduce the feeling of death, a terrifying, unnerving, and alarming feeling. Among the silence of the sky, its eyes scan the land below, looking, searching for something to prey on. Like a grim reaper, it continues the process of death. It's Argentavis. So, what exactly was Argentavis? How big could it actually get? And what about its paleobiology? Argentavis magnificens was possibly only surpassed in wingspan by Paleobiologist Sanderse, described in 2014 as an extinct species of flying bird, whose fossil remains date from 25 million years ago, with a wingspan estimated between 20 and 24 feet, giving it the largest wingspan of any flying bird yet discovered, twice that of the wandering albatross, which has the largest wingspan of any extant flying bird, at up to 12 feet. Only the long-extinct pterosaurs could have rivaled and exceeded its size. Think Quetzalcoatlus. Argentavis literally means magnificent Argentine bird. Argentavis was once the record holder of the largest bird, and is also known as the giant pteratorn. It was a member of an extinct group of predatory birds called the pteratorns, or monster birds, related to storks and New World vultures such as condors and turkey vultures. Nonetheless, Argentavis dwarfed even the huge Andean condor, weighing 6 times more and with a wingspan twice as long. It is known from 3 sites in the Ipiquen and Andalhuala formations in central and northwestern Argentina, dating to the late Miocene, 9 to 6.8 million years ago, where some high-quality sample fossils have been discovered. The single lone humerus or upper arm bone specimen of Argentavis is relatively damaged. Despite that, it allows scientists to estimate its length accurately. Its humerus was only slightly shorter than an entire human arm. Argentavis had stout, powerful legs and large feet, which enabled it to walk with ease. Its bill was large, rather slender, and had a hooked tip with a wide gape. Argentavis's wingspan estimates varied largely depending on how it was measured or scaled, including, for instance, regression analysis or comparisons with the California condor. At one time, wingspans have been published for the species up to around 24 to 26 feet, but more recent estimates put the wingspan more likely in the range of 16 to 21 feet, meaning that it was large, but not as large as previously thought. Currently, Paleobiologist Sanderse, described in 2014 as having a wingspan of around 23 to 24 feet, claims the title for the largest bird to have ever existed. When standing on the ground, it had an estimated height of around 5 to 6 feet, with a length of 11 feet from bill tip to tail tip. Previously published weights give Argentavis a body mass of 180 pounds, but more refined techniques show a typical mass would have been around 155 to 160 pounds, though weights vary depending on conditions. Nonetheless, there is some good news for Argentavis, as it has the record of being the heaviest flying bird to have ever existed, by a considerable amount, as Paleobiologist weighed no more than 50 to 90 pounds. Imagine the wandering albatross, but almost twice the size, or the Andean condor, the largest extant land bird on average wingspan and weight, with a 10-foot-long wingspan and weight of up to 33 pounds, as similar to what could have been Argentavis, a terror of the skies. New World vultures, which I will introduce quickly, like the condor, are 7 extant species, with 5 extant vultures and 2 extant condors found in warm and temperate areas of the Americas, being scavengers, feeding from carcasses of dead animals without apparent ill effects. Bacteria in the food source, pathogenic to other vertebrates, dominate the vulture's gut flora. And vultures benefit from the bacterial breakdown of carrion tissue. These New World vultures are thought to be the closest living relations to Argentavis and other pteratorns. Average weights are drastically less in both the albatross at around 19 pounds and the condor at around 25 pounds. The largest flying creatures to have ever existed are archosaurs, a group including pterosaurs, namely the Asdarchid pterosaurs of the Cretaceous, the wingspans of late Asdarchids such as Quetzalcoatlus and Hatzegopteryx, two huge prehistoric beasts, have been estimated to exceed 33 feet, and some even claim to exceed 40 feet. Asdarchids weighed from around 450 to 550 pounds, with a height similar to that of an elephant, and almost double the height of Argentavis at over 10 feet. I'm going to get a little specific here, but it's interesting. Currently accepted estimates for the size of Argentavis are a wingspan of around 16 to 21 feet, a wing area of around 87 square feet, a wing loading of 1.77 pounds per feet squared, a body length of around 11.5 feet, a height of around 5 to 6 feet, and a mass of around 155 to 160 pounds. Comparison with extant birds suggests that it laid one or two eggs with a mass of around 2 pounds every 2 years. For reference, an ostrich egg weighs 3 pounds, which means it was slightly smaller. Mates might have exchanged duties of incubating and procuring food every few days, and young were independent after some 16 months but not fully mature until aged about a dozen years. To support the cave strategy, or where an animal species lives at the extent of its ecosystem, limited with very little fluctuation in total numbers, Argentavis most probably invested a lot of time and effort into raising a small number of young that would have stayed with the parent birds for a considerable amount of time. This would have given the young more time to grow strong, while greatly reducing the level of infant mortality in the species. This would also help stabilize the population numbers, reducing the risk of overbreeding, as the parents would not breed again until a time when the young were at a stage of development where they could survive on their own. At the time, its only possible threat would have been terror birds, yet Argentavis had the option of flight, while they didn't. Most paleontologists believe it was a very long-lived bird, with a lifespan measurable in decades. Mortality must have been relatively low to maintain a viable population, less than about 2% of birds may have died each year. Argentavis suffered hardly any predation, and mortality was mainly from old age, accidents, and disease. How such a large bird like Argentavis could fly has been the key area of study associated with this bird, something that has sparked interesting conclusions. There is no question that Argentavis flew, for it had all the traits of modern flyers in terms of physiology and structures such as light, hollow bones, and strong, sturdy wings. The question is, how did it fly? And this has puzzled paleontologists given its immense size as compared to modern birds. How did it get its large bulk off the ground in the first place? Sankar Chatterjee from the Museum of Texas Tech University decided to model the giant's flying style by running simulations with known fossils. He discovered that Argentavis simply couldn't have generated enough lift from a running takeoff. It needed height to get airborne, but it could manage with surprisingly little. Albatrosses and hang glider pilots use the same technique nowadays. Once in the air, the flapping flight that small birds use was out of question for the giant predator. By studying its skeleton, Chatterjee estimated the maximum amount of power that its fly muscles could have generated, and while substantial, it was still 3.5 times less than the minimum amount of power needed to fly. Rather, Chatterjee deduced that Argentavis was a master glider, capable of soaring for great distances at a shallow angle of 3 degrees, continually reshaping its wings to control its glide and flying with grace. The ability to fly isn't a simple question of weight ratios. Rather, size and structure of the wing must also be considered. A wing loading of 25 kilograms per meter squared is considered the limit for avian flight as a rule of thumb. Wing loading is, in aerodynamics, the total mass of an aircraft divided by the area of its wing. Currently, the heaviest birds weigh up to 46 pounds, with the European Great Bustard and the African Cory Bustard as contenders. Meanwhile, the Saris Crane is the tallest flying bird alive, with a height of up to almost 6 feet, rivaling Argentavis. Like modern soarers, Chatterjee believes that Argentavis used two techniques. By flying along the Andean ridges, it stayed aloft using upwards air currents produced by wind deflected up the cliffs. The multiple fossils discovered at the Andean foothills support this theory. In other words, scientists, based on assumptions of the size and structure of its wings, inferred that Argentavis magnificens flew mainly by soaring, using flapping flight only during small periods. How do we know this? Well, due to the fact that the keel of the breastbone is quite small. This suggests that the main flight muscles were reduced when compared to other flying birds, leading scientists to believe that even though the wings were huge, Argentavis didn't have the stamina to continuously flap them. It is probable that it used thermal currents as well. In other words, as a result of these underdeveloped muscles, Argentavis relied upon prevailing wind currents to keep itself aloft, with flapping only occurring during the takeoff and landing phases. This would see Argentavis using its large wings to exploit a combination of thermal updrafts as well as dynamic soaring. In a nutshell, dynamic soaring is when a flying creature uses the boundary between two air masses to pick up speed by cartwheeling into incoming wind and using the wing speed to accelerate itself forward. Repeating this process increases the speed of the bird and the resulting effect of the maneuver, leading to extremely energy-efficient flight, one that is now even used by human glider pilots to stay airborne for longer periods of time. It has been estimated that the minimal velocity for the wing of Argentavis Magnificens is about 36 feet per second, or 25 miles per hour, and a top speed of around 40 miles per hour, allowing it to scan vast tracts of land for prey. It's an extremely energy-efficient style today, and eagles and vultures use it to great effect, sometimes covering hundreds of miles without a single wing flap. When the birds switch from the mountains to the wide, open spaces of the pampas, the extensive treeless plains in South America, it switched to a different method, thermal soaring, where rising columns of hot air provided it with lift. A thermal column is a column of rising air in the lower altitudes of Earth's atmosphere, a form of atmospheric updraft, or atmospheric current of rising air, often within a cloud. Cumulus clouds reveal the location of thermal columns, and by flying around one, Argentavis could have risen through the air, giving itself enough height to soar to the next thermal column. Despite its large size, Chatterjee calculated that Argentavis was maneuverable enough to manage the tight circular turns needed to stay within a thermal column. Especially for takeoff, it would have depended on the wind. Despite the fact that its legs were strong enough to provide it with a running or jumping start, the wings were simply too long to flap effectively until the bird was some height off the ground. Additionally, skeletal evidence suggests that its breast muscles weren't powerful enough for wing flapping over extended periods of time. It may have used mountain slopes and headwinds to take off, and probably could manage to do so from even gently sloping terrain with little effort. It may have flown and lived much like a modern Andean condor, scanning large areas of land from aloft for carrion. At the time, the climate of the Andean foothills in Argentina during the late Miocene was warmer and drier than today, which would have further helped the bird in staying aloft atop thermal updrafts. This climate was just the weather needed for generating the powerful thermals needed to lift such a large bird. Studies on condor flight indicated that Argentavis was fully capable of flight in normal conditions, as modern large soaring birds spend little time flapping their wings, regardless of environment. Argentavis's territories measured around 190 square miles, which the bird scanned for food, possibly using a generally north-south direction to avoid being slowed by adverse winds. Thus, it was a carnivore. This species seems less aerodynamically suited for predation than its relatives. It probably preferred a scavenger of carrion, and it possibly habitually chased the mammalian metatherian carnivores, like Thylacus milidae. Due to the fact that being an active predator wasn't a possibility because of its body shape and weak breast muscles, Argentavis was probably a scavenger, possibly similar to an Andean condor. Additionally, scavenging would also require little in the way of active movement, reducing the required number of calories to keep its body going. Unlike extant condors and vultures, territorians usually have long, eagle-like beaks and are believed to have been active predators. It may have also used its wings and size to intimidate lone land predators of their kills. They may have also ambushed some small live prey like large rodents, small armadillos, and the young of large animals like ground sloths. It would have required, compared to humans, a relatively large amount of meat each day, around 5.5 to 11 pounds. When hunting actively, Argentavis would have swooped from high above onto their prey, which they usually would have been able to grab by its bill, kill, and swallow without landing. Nonetheless, they may too have lied in wait from a ground position, which would render them likely grounded until heavy winds allowed them to fly. Skull structure suggests that it may eat most of its prey whole, as opposed to tearing off pieces of flesh. The huge size of Argentavis meant that it would have had little trouble in driving off smaller mammalian predators. Nonetheless, it should be kept in mind that apex predators of Miocene South America were the ground-dwelling terror birds, such as Forus rachis and Kalenkin, capable of taking down large prey. So it may have been the case that these apex predators provided a large amount of carrion that supported Argentavis' scavenging. While it is impossible to say how long Argentavis lived, its large size and possibly sedate lifestyle, when compared to other more active predators, indicate that it was possibly long-lived. Its large size meant that it had no known predators in the air, while ground predators were simply too small to be a threat. And you might be suggesting, well, what about for his rackets? And I tell you, they might have been a problem, but Argentavis still had the option of flight, while they didn't. The combination of these factors leads paleontologists to lean more towards the long-lived bird theory, with a lifespan measurable in decades. It was named by Campbell and Tony in 1980. Argentavis has appeared in Ark Survival Evolved, where few other creatures come close to being used so often, and being so versatile and resourceful as the Argy, or Argentavis, a terror of the skies and a prehistoric beast. Argentavis prowled the pampas in search for its next victim, gliding slowly and swiftly and equipped with a sharpened beak, immense wings, and a wingspan of a maximum of 21 feet. It's true, Palaeognathus had a bigger wingspan, but as the previous record holder, it also deserves recognition. I believe that to be this majestic creature in flesh would be an enthralling experience. Besides, it has the record of being the heaviest flying bird to have ever existed by a considerable amount. Argentavis Magnificens. Striking. Terrifying. Heavy. Thank you for watching. This is Enchiridion. See you next time.